Thanks to light pollution, most people on Earth will never see the arm of the Milky Way galaxy. It's visible to the naked eye when you're in dark enough skies. The brightest skies where I've been able to see the Milky Way galaxy is from the field of my astronomy club, where it's a Bortle 5 zone. And it has to be really good seeing. But once you start getting into Bortle 4, 3, or even better skies, the arm of the Milky Way galaxy becomes more apparent and it is breathtaking every time I see it. I wish that everyone on Earth gets a chance to see the Milky Way at least once in their lifetime. It is not as rare as a total solar eclipse, but it is becoming more and more rare due to light pollution. I also love doing Milky Way time-lapses because it shows the rotation of the Earth from Earth itself. In this track time-lapse from 2022, you can see the exact rotation of the Earth when we track the Milky Way from rise all the way to set in the morning. And in this video, we're going to do a similar time lapse. It'll be the time lapse you saw in the very beginning. Those images were taken from Vermont in July 2023 during a four-night trip, of which all four nights saw rain and thunderstorms. But the night before we were about to leave at 1 a.m., the clouds decided to clear. And the only reason I noticed is because I was playing around with my laser pointer and I saw some speckles of light in the sky. I normally dedicate 15 to 20 minutes doing test shots, but because I had such limited time, I just went with my gut. And these are the settings I used on my Canon T5i. It's a stock DSLR and I used a Samyang 14mm f2.8. wide angle lens. And the settings for this I used is ISO 6400. It's really high. Normally I do between 800 to 1600, maybe even 3200. I did 20 second exposures. Normally I do between 10 and 15 seconds. And if it's a track shot, I'll go all the way up to a minute. I bumped my F ratio to F3.2 just to try and get sharp enough stars. And I would also try F4.0 on this lens as well. And I took about 220 frames. I take all of my images in RAW, so my camera saves it as .cr2. And we'll take these images into Lightroom and do some minor corrections using the camera RAW filter utilities that are in Lightroom. It is the same ones that we see in Photoshop. This will allow us to tease out some more detail of each of the frames in the Milky Way galaxy. Once we're done, we'll export everything out into JPEG, into a sequenced JPEG, and then import it into Premiere Pro. The reason I save it as JPEG instead of keeping it as RAW is because Premiere Pro cannot read RAW images. We'll also do it as 1080p. Depending on the size of your images, you can go much larger, but I'm just gonna keep it simple, do 1080p and upload that. So let's open up Lightroom and see what we can do with our images. So here are all of my CR2 files on my desktop here. You can see I have 226 of these items here. Some of these have some red lights here. This is my headlamp. I didn't realize I was hitting the roof of the porch and it was bouncing right into my camera. Again, I had a lot of things that was going wrong that day, including, as I mentioned, my dew heater broke. So like around like here, you can see it starts getting hazy. That's because the dew heater could not keep the dew off my lens. So here I have all of my raw images on my desktop here. I have 226 of them. You can see some red lights here, and that's because I didn't realize my headlamp was bouncing off the porch of that Airbnb and making a glow in the lens. So many things that went wrong that night. But anyways, this is just a proof of concept to show you my workflow for creating Milky Way time lapses. I have Lightroom open. I have a new folder. So here I'm going to select all of them. I'm going through deselect some of these images that has like the red hue from my headlamp so that I don't create some kind of flashing effect anywhere. And I think I got all of them, 215. Sure, I'm gonna open Lightroom and I'm gonna click and drag them all into here. And you can see them being added here. I think that's all of them, 215, yep. Okay, I'm gonna do one quick look over to see if there's any that I need to deselect. And I think I got, I'll deselect this one. So there's gonna be 214, which is great. Okay, add 214. All right, so they all got edited. I'm just gonna do a quick look over and you can see, and as I mentioned, that some dew started forming. So you can see exactly around when my dew heater decided to break. It's like probably like around here. You can see the tree starting to get hazy. But anyways, I'm here. I'm gonna select one that looks good and I'm going to edit it and then apply it to everything else. So click this one, I'm gonna click the next one. There's no red hue here. Once you double click on them, you open it, you click on the little edit option here, and then you'll see something that's familiar to you if you use Photoshop is the camera raw filter settings here, and I can make this look a little bit better so that in the time lapse the Milky Way stands out a little bit more than what's already shown here. So if I decrease the exposure a little bit, it'll help fight the high ISO settings that I used. Whoops. 10%, 5%, 20%. I want to do 15. Whoop. 0.15, not minus 15. Doing any contrast, maybe a tiny bit. You should play with your settings to see what makes your images pop a little bit more. You don't have to follow exactly what I'm doing. I'm just showing you my steps on making this pop a little bit more. And then you can click on the little eye to see the before and after. It looks a little bit darker, and I think it brings out some more of the details in the Milky Way. You can see the star trails from the 20-second exposures, which isn't too bad. I thought it would be worse than what it is here. Not going to do saturation, and the one thing I do like doing is the dehaze, which in Photoshop is under the general category, but in Lightroom is under effects. But before I do that, I'm actually going to go all the way down here and click on this enable lens correction. So if you know the type of lens you used, Lightroom and Photoshop, they all have a whole lot of these profiles. I haven't really used this very much, but after talking with one of my buddies, Jesse, on how to, on him using this for his, 135mm Samyang, I decided to start to use this to see what it looks like. So I'm going to click on Change Profile. The make for me is Samyang, not Samsung, Samyang. And it auto-selected 14mm because I obviously picked this, so it has that selected as default. But anyways, I'll click OK. If you uncheck this, just look at the images here, you'll see that it kind of just doesn't get, it just like bulbs out a little bit, and then you click on this, it becomes a little bit flatter, so the edges become a little better to see. You do lose some of the stars here, but I think it's worth it to make your image look a little bit flatter. And now once you have this, you can go up here under dehaze and then start dehazing it, and it'll remove some of the glow in the sky. I find that after doing the lens correction, the dehaze changes a little bit more subtle and more visible, or easier to see, as opposed to doing it with the lens correction. If you go the other way, you lose the Milky Way, obviously. So I'm just going to do 60%, which is quite a lot. But anyways, like before and after, you can see that it does make a difference. You can see more of the sky here. You can also play with the noise reduction settings. So I'm just going to zoom in, and I'm going to do just a tiny bit of noise reduction, maybe 15%. You know, before and after. Since we're not stacking any of these, this is a good way of getting rid of some of the noise, whereas when you stack, the stacking process gets rid of most of the noise for you. And then if you want, you can play with the saturation, the HSL, hue, saturation, luminance here to make your image look a little bit better. You can, for the saturation for the green, you can make it tone down a little bit so that if you have green tint like around here, it starts to get removed. So let's see, there you go. Of course, there's some green around the tree here that gets removed, but it's night. It was very, very dark that night, so it doesn't really matter. And then you can do before and after. I think the after looks a lot better with the green going all the way down. And one other saturation point you can try and do is the red. If you're using an astromodded DSLR, you'll catch a lot of the hydrogen alpha that's coming out of space, but I am using a stock DSLR. But if I up the red, you can see that some of the red in the galaxy starts to appear a little bit better, but again, I'm not going to do too much, just for some details. Again, play with what you have. And I think this is all the settings I'm going to do. If I look at the next one, so this is before, and then this is after. One way to copy the settings over is when you're here, you click on Control C, or you can right click and you do copy edit settings, and then go to the next one, right click and Control V or paste edit settings, and you'll see that it just edits, paste it all. And what I like doing is I'll go back to the view here and I'll pick out another random one, like especially like one of these hazy ones. I'll paste settings. So it flattens it out. Of course, you know, because there was so much dew here, I don't have a lot of details in the Milky Way. I'm going to keep it in the time lapse anyway because I think it creates a cool effect and also make sure that I don't have a gap in how the Milky Way moves across the sky. So I think I'm happy with this. So you can select all of this by doing Control A, select all of them, and then you can do Control V to paste settings, or you can right click and do paste edit settings here, and it'll affect it to all 214. So I click OK, and it's going to take about a minute or so, and it'll start pasting them all one by one. And you can see the progress here. You can see that the image is starting to change one by one. And I'll let it go, and with the power of editing, let's skip forward. All right, so that affected all of them. Looks pretty good. Once you're satisfied, you can click right-click after you select all of them, export all of them. You can do TIFF, DNG, and other originals plus settings, which will save it as a CR2, but edit it. Dimensions, it's custom, so I did 1920 so that I can make a 1080p video. It'll be slightly wider, but it'll get cut down when I do the edits, which is perfectly fine. And the quality, 100% great. And one thing you want to make sure you do is you give a custom name. So I have custom name VT Milky Way. I'll just change to Vermont Milky Way Vermont. And you want to start the number at wherever. You just want to make sure that it's a continuous number, because then you can import them as a sequence. It makes things a lot easier once you get it into Premiere Pro. So I'm going to click on export, and I'm in my Milky Way time-lapse directory. I'm going to create another one, call it just making JPEG. Select folder. All right, that exported everything. I go here, and I have 214 items to look at. And you want a preview of what the time-lapse will look like, and open it, and just go through it in the arrow. Of course, not full res, but you can see it go through, and you can see the shift in the camera. It's probably where I kicked it. Yeah, but it's okay. Now we're going to open up Adobe Premiere Pro, import it as a sequence, and save our time lapse as an MP4. Let's go to that next. Okay, so I'm going to open up Premiere Pro here in the new project window. And we're going to name it VT Milky Way. Sure, it's just create a new sequence. It never creates one for me for some reason. Create. All right, so to do a new sequence here, you can right-click and do new sequence here. So I like doing new item and then new sequence. 1024, sure, the default DSLR settings, 24 FPS. 1920, great, that's what I'll keep it at. And click OK. All right, so that's there. Now, and then we're gonna right-click here again. We're gonna do import. And then you'll navigate to where your JPEG files are. And if you click on the first one, you'll see that this checkbox becomes checked. It says image sequence. And that's one of the cool things about this, is that it'll import all of them as a sequence as like one big video file, which is pretty cool. If you want to import it as just one file, you can uncheck it and you'll just import that one file. But click on this, import sequence, and then click open. And you'll see that it created a 7-second video. So now I can drag that into my timeline here, keep existing settings, let's do this, make that one a little bit bigger, okay, and then there we go, and then click play. Actually, if you want to edit this a little bit, you can. So as I said before, it's a little bit taller. So if I look at the image settings here, it's 1920 by 1280, so not 1080. So it's about 200 pixels taller. So we can actually move this down here so that you get more of the Milky Way. Whoops. Less of the trees. I think I'm happy with that framing. I click play. Oh, it's like struggling, it's going back for some reason. The way to fix that is if you do sequence, then render into out, let it render the preview here, and then it'll play a little bit better. You'll see it's green, less struggling. It's what it looks like. And then the kick. There we go. So it looks pretty good, right? And you can affect the speed duration, so it's about 7 seconds. So if I change this to, let's say 75, you can do 10%, 10 seconds, and it'll update accordingly. And then you can see what the frame rate looks like. I'll do render again. This only takes a couple of seconds. And there you go. So you can see I get a smooth preview. And I think this speed is a little bit better. Just shift again. The shift is something I don't like, but whatever. So I think this looks good. And this is a great way to do this. And I think what I'm going to do here is just gonna move this back up. Render. Yeah, I think this looks good. It is syncing. This is the Earth's rotation doing this, no matter what anyone else says. And of course, once you're done, you can click on File, Export, or do Control M, Media, and then it just took a while. You can save it as sequence, but I'll do V1. I'm calling it V1 because knowing me, I'll do like 4 more versions before I upload it. But you do this, you click on Export, and it'll save as H.264 format, which is an MP4 format, and there's no audio. You can save some time by doing no audio, but whatever. Click OK, export, and there you go. It'll export in about 10 seconds, and we can play it in Windows Media Player. So I'll do that as well. There we go. And here is what it looks like.